about prayer and fasting for fruitfulness. And I just want to start off by like saying that 2018 wasn't as I had imagined. I remember last year during winter workshop, I had all this vision, I had all these goals. I wanted to rely on God so much. And I think that I felt really short because I was put myself in the battle alone with God. And as even if I was praying and fasting, I didn't do it with other sisters with me. And that's what I really want to focus on in my short charge today, is to inspire us to really be with one another in the battle. So my first point is rend your heart. And so I also really like definitions. And so the word rend, it means to break apart or to tear. And when you break a bone, when you tear a muscle, it hurts. It's like, you know? But I love this scripture in Joel. I still remember the first time I read it as a disciple, and I was like, wow, this is the answer to a lack of fruitfulness. And so in Joel chapter 2, I want to start in verse 12. It says, "Even now declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God." And I love this scripture. And in Joel 1, it kind of talked about how the people's joy was withered away. And when we're not focused on the lost and being fruitful and doing it together, our joy can be withered away. And so I love how in this scripture, it talks about who God is and what he wants. He wants to give us these blessings, but it takes a rendering of our heart to do that. And I wanted to say an example for when I was in the Chafee ministry. Back in 2016, we got sent out. It was me, Alicia, Alex Medina, and another guy named AJ. And it was some of the most faith-building times in my walk with God. I was a four-month-old disciple, and I was really struggling because I didn't really have faith in God, honestly, at that point. But Alicia, like, chose me to go with her, and I was like, oh, my gosh, why me, you know? But I really appreciated her because she actually gave each one of us prayer journals individually. Wow. And so not only that, but she gave a prayer journal for all of us to have, and it circulated amongst all of us, and we got to be connected to each other through our prayers. Wow. And because of that, all glory to God, that we doubled our ministry by the end of the semester. And I think also of that same year, I got to meet one of my best friends, Samantha Maurer, and it was just an ordinary day. And I remember I had a lot of prayers, you know, crying out to God and just, you know, give me that one soul, you know, just one soul that I can pour my heart into. And I was super intimidated by her, sweet little Sam. I still get preached about it and I get so embarrassed. I'm like, I know I was intimidated, but you know, like God uses all situations. And now she's leading that same campus ministry at Chafee with her boyfriend. Wow. So God does miracles, you guys, and like he can use anyone. So like my first point, rend your heart, it's really just about having a brokenness for the lost and praying with one another for it. So a practical that I'd like to give is very similar to what Leanne was saying, was to be praying with each other. I think we all pray to God every day, we have our quiet times, but really praying together is what's going to unify us and be stronger and more bold. And my second point is dream dreams and see visions. And so later on in Joel 2, in verse 28, it says, "And afterward, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days." And so I think we all recognize the scripture. It's in Acts 2, right before 3,000 people get added to the first century church. And I fully believe that if we incorporate this heart of having a broken heart for the lost and also involving fasting, we're going to be able to see the same result in our campus ministries. And so, I'm just really excited to see what 2019 holds. Let's really do this together. As a campus ministry. So yeah, love you guys.
Amen. Well, my short charge today is fruitful through restoration. And we know the Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, that the devil prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. And as disciples, we have an enemy, and he is real. He is scheming to destroy your faith, to kill you spiritually. And not only you, but the sisters around you in this room, right? And sadly, we do see people around us get devoured by Satan. He takes them out spiritually. And it's always so heartbreaking to see someone fall away. But amazingly, God is so gracious that he has provided a way back for those who have fallen away. And I believe that a key component to helping people restore their relationship with God is found in Romans chapter 12, along with many other things, but I feel like this is a key thing. Romans chapter 12, very, very simple short scripture. In verse 9, it says, "Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil and cling to what is good." And here just the Bible says love must be sincere, right? Love is so powerful. People are impacted and moved when they see the love of the disciples. They come and they're like, "I have never seen anything like this before." And I don't know how you felt when you saw the love of the kingdom and how moved you were, right? And so when we get baptized, we feel all the love. But sadly, when people fall away, you know, a lot of times they share that they no longer feel loved anymore, or they've lost their friends, right? Because I'm not part of the church, then they don't want to be my friend. And they can feel that the love or the friendships in the kingdom were not sincere, right? But an example, we're not going to turn there, but in John 21, we see Jesus love Peter. He goes and he looks for Peter. Peter had left. He had gone back to fishing. But Jesus goes out of his way to look for Peter. He loves him. He feeds him, right? And he restores him back. And Peter becomes the preacher that preaches for the Israelites and or the Jewish people. and he ushers in the kingdom, right? And so, you know, when it comes to followaways, we must stop having the mindset of the out of sight, out of mind, right? Because we don't see them, we just don't go after them. And as a young Christian, I know for me, I had a few friends, my best friends fell away, including the woman that reached out to me and baptized me, and that was so hurtful. But I stayed in touch with them. I love them. Our friendship was sincere. And so we continued to have that friendship in those talks. And a few months later, this woman got restored. And also one of my best friends had fallen away. And I remember just doing everything I could to look for her. I went to her house. I went to her grandma's house. I called her phone number. I mean, she changed her phone number, deleted me, just MIA. Even my family, I brought her into my family. My family was like, "You need to go find this girl. Like, I love this girl." And I remember for a whole year, I prayed and just cried in tears. And I prayed for her on my knees that God would bring her back. I just wanted to know she was okay. I just love this girl. And 2 weeks before I moved to Las Vegas on the mission team, I was putting like a slideshow of all the campus ministry for in Irvine. And I get a phone number, or a text from an unknown number, and she's like, "Hey, this is so-and-so, I'm ready to come back 2 weeks before I move to Las Vegas." And I ended up moving, like 2 weeks later, she got restored. And we don't know, you are that lifeline to that person that has fallen away. And so I don't know who you were close to that can get restored this year. And I just wanna leave you with this challenge. Right now, write down 3 names that you can think of people they were close to that has fallen away. And pray for them every day. Love them. Make an effort to reach out for them. And the question is, who are you going to go after this year that you are going to help restore? And to God be all the glory.
All right. Are you guys fired up? All right. Good afternoon, ladies. My name is Monica, and I have this charge to give you guys a personal vision for fruitfulness and leadership. I wanted to share a song, and excuse my voice, but it says, "Give me your eyes," and the lyric goes as follows. "Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see." My title today is Rise Up, O Women of God. It is time to see what I see. Wow. My goal today is to help you ladies not only just see physically, because I can't even see that well, thank God for context, but I mean to actually see, to see the way that God sees. And I wanted to share Helen Keller's quote. You know, she was blind, but she said, The only thing worse than being blind is having sight but no vision. To have sight, it's the act or power of seeing. But to have vision, that is to believe in something so much that you would do whatever it takes to see it happen. In 2 Corinthians 5, 7, it says, "For we live by faith, not by sight." Let's take a glimpse at the book of Ruth. I like how Leanne gave us a good illustration of it. So I'll just share a little bit about Naomi and Ruth. But Naomi was disheartened as she not only lost a husband, but two sons. The thought of being a spiritual mom to someone, yet alone fruitful, was out of, like, she wasn't thinking about that. But let's talk about Ruth as well. She was equally discouraged as she had lost a husband, and she had lost faith. But how could God use two imperfect people for his perfect plan? And I wanted to share a story. I wanted to share my story. Actually, going to USC, normally I have a lot of vision, but I started to see the women there, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like, I'm not that rich. I don't have nice clothes. I started to get intimidated and fearful, like, can I do something in this campus? And I started to walk and pray through the campus, and I went to this place called the Little Chapel. And that's where I got vision, guys. Wow. I opened this book, and it's like this little chapel, right? But when you read their prayers, there was women that said, "God, thank you because I was about to commit suicide. Wow. God, thank you for letting me be here because you've given me a chance for an education and to further my family." Wow. And I started to think, there is a chance for these women. I can make an impact. Wow. And so I prayed, and I'm like, "God, anyone, I don't care who." And there was this one girl with food. I'm like, come on, girl. Come on, girl. That was Tracy. Tracy only came for the food. But you know what? Amen. Shows God working, and I'm not that awesome. But it was awesome because as she comes to Bible talk, she studies the Bible. You know, she gets baptized. But the most inspiring thing, and a little bit discouraging, she broke my heart because she said, "You know, Monica, I know that you've given me vision, but I don't know if I can do it. I don't know if I can be fruitful." And I looked at Tracy, and I'm like, "Tracy, why? Like, what do you mean? You're a disciple." And she said, "I just doubt myself, and I can't even speak English." And I told her, "Tracy, if you're writing notes, if you're sharing your faith, you are going to be fruitful." And as I went to Chicago on my birthday, I was like, you know, I got these happy birthday texts and calls. But the best thing, I get the text from Tracy, "Monica, I'm about to be fruitful." This girl inspired me so much that I leave you with something, a quote, and it says, "When you can't make them see the light, make them feel the heat."
Mighty West region, and I'm so excited to be here, yet nervous to share with you all what I feel like I'm not very strong in, but let's learn together in how to schedule our lives to be fruitful. Let's turn to Luke 14, verse 28. In verse 28, it says, "Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it?" And who of us woke up today and was like, "Oh, I'm going to build a tower"? Any of us? No, right? Building a tower requires planning, getting advice, planning, finding a designer, and more planning. And that's exactly what it takes to be fruitful. We need to plan our lives. When we counted the cost to be baptized, we also counted the cost on what it took to be fruitful. Amen. And that means our schedules were baptized with us as well. Amen. Who here has ever felt that they just didn't have time to be fruitful? Right. None of us. We are all like, "Oh, our lives, we have so much going on." But in for me, when I first got baptized, I was like, oh, I'm a full-time student. I'm going to be fruitful in my classes. And then homework started. And then I was working full-time. I was like, oh, my gosh, there's so much. And then I wasn't in school anymore, and I was a full-time worker. And I was like, oh, work, I'm so tired. I have meetings with the body. I can't be fruitful. And then I was a full-time intern, and I was like, oh my gosh, this schedule's crazy. And then I was a part-time intern, and I was a part-time nanny and a full-time worker, and I was like, I don't know how I'm gonna put fruitfulness into my life. But for me, I had to make a decision. I had to make a decision to schedule my life to be fruitful, and God blessed it. In Hebrews 12, verse 1, it says to throw off everything that hinders us. And newsflash, we can be hindered by our lives, and we need to throw off everything and make time for God to work through us. And now, I'm not saying to neglect your studies and to not work and not pay rent. No, 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 no. I'm saying to monitor your time and be productive with it. Even Solomon believed in scheduling. In Ecclesiastes 3, he says that there's a time for everything. There's a time to plan, and there's a time to be fruitful. So my one and only point is self-control to live life to the full.
Nice.
I don't know about you guys, but every year I make a decision to get a planner, and then at the end of January, it's kind of just sitting on my desk or my bookshelf, and it's blank, and then by the end of the year, it's also blank. And I just never had the self-control or discipline to actually use it. And the only time in my discipleship life where I felt like I had a schedule and I could actually use it and keep it was when I went to Hong Kong. I landed and I was like, oh my gosh, I'm so overwhelmed. I'm in a new country. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know these people. I don't know the language. And I got there and I landed and Joe and Carrie greeted me and they were like, oh, here's your schedule. And I was like, a schedule? What? I didn't know we had those as interns. But it made me so calm and at peace with where my life was. I was like, oh, a schedule, thank God. Something to stick to, and I knew where I was going. And that's exactly what schedules do. They give us a direction on where to go. When we have a clear schedule, we will have a clear mind, and we can easily give more to our people and the lost. When I don't have a clear schedule, I find myself either saying no to things my leaders have asked of me because it's not convenient for me, or I don't feel like it, or I become overwhelmed by how much I've taken on and I just don't know how to get to it. In Acts 24, verse 24 and 25, Paul's in front of Felix, and Paul's discipling him on being righteous and self-controlled, and Felix is overwhelmed, and he's like, oh, wait, stop discipling. Okay, I'll talk to you when it's convenient for me. But we need to not imitate Felix in this area when it comes to discipling. We need to become more self-controlled in how we use our time. Things that are asked of you will never be convenient for you. But if you're self-controlled in your schedule and righteous in your attitude, you're able to take on more than you think and even doing more last-minute tasks. Let's be honest. It wasn't convenient for Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, yet he did it because he loved us. And I have 5 quick practicals for you. Number 1, buy and use a planner. Pray about your schedule, that God will bless your plans, Proverbs 16:9. Number 3, talk to your discipler about what a great schedule would look like for you. Number 4, be open to changing your schedule in order to be more effective. And number 5, teach your people to be bold in their schedules so we can bring glory to God by bearing much fruit. I will leave you with this. You will never find time for anything. If you want time to be fruitful, you must make it. Jesus had the same 24 hours in a day that we do. What will you do with yours? To God be all the glory.
Amen. Good evening, ladies. My name is Jessie Rojo, and I have the privilege to share with you guys expecting every member to be fruitful. Can I ask you guys a question? Like, can I just start? Is that allowed? Like, can I start off with a question? Okay. Do you believe that every woman in your Bible talk can be personally fruitful in 2019?
Absolutely.
Well, let's find out. John 15, verse 8. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Jesus believes that every disciple can and must bear much fruit. Not just fruit, much fruit. And I think for me, sometimes I can have a lack of faith in the scripture. Like, sometimes I just don't believe this to be true for me. But It is true. It's the Bible. And I think that if being fruitful, A, brings God glory, and B, shows us to be disciples, then of course God is going to allow us to become fruitful. Right. Of course we will bear much fruit in 2019. Amen? And I think for you ladies, this is a conviction that not only you have to have, but instill in every single woman in your Bible talk. I kind of wanted to work backwards in figuring out what this meant, and I did some research on a fruitless tree, what it's like to be fruitless. A professional landscaper wrote an article, and he stated that you must absolutely cut down a fruitless tree. And I was like, it's fruitless, like it's harmless, like. It's not bothering anyone, it's just sitting there, right? But no, there's actually really harmful consequences to leaving a dead tree sitting in your landscape. One, its roots start to grow down for a frantic effort to get alive again, and it ends up damaging all the piping and water and oil piping underground. Two, it ends up growing this fungus, like really gross fungus, and it ends up infecting the soil, and all the other trees die because of it. And so I think, like, I don't know if you guys can relate, but I think sometimes I believe God makes natural phenomenons happen as a spiritual, like, reference to our life in the kingdom. Yeah. And this is what a fruitless disciple looks like. We must bear fruit. Yeah. Another illustration that I want to share about someone who I really admire, who expects every member to be fruitful, is my awesome co-leader. And I'm not just sharing about him because he's my boyfriend. I think he's awesome. And Levi, when we crash landed in LBCC in April, he had about 3 to 4 guys, some OG guys who have been at LBCC for a while, and they're awesome. And 8 months later, now Levi was able to instill the conviction of personal evangelism in every member and in each one of his guys, and he was able to double his number in his men. And so it's just personally for me, I feel very inspired to become fruitful in 2019. I think to reiterate, to ask the question again, do you believe that every woman in your ministry can be fruitful? Is this something that you truly have faith in for your women and for yourself? And I think some challenges that I have for you guys is, one, have that sit-down personal evangelism talk with each member in your Bible talk. Bible talk leader or not, have the talk with every woman in your Bible talk. And we're all our sister's keepers. And so ask the simple questions, you know, how much do you share your faith? When's the last time you were fruitful? Up to what study can you lead? And help them out from there and get them some awesome vision, some goals as to how much fruit they want to bear in 2019. A second goal that I have for you guys is to pray and fast for fruit, not only for yourselves, but inspire your women as well to pray and fast for fruit in the Bible talk. And I think, I really truly believe, like the scripture says, that we will and we must bear much fruit in 2019. And by this, we will show everyone that we are disciples. I love you guys.
Well, good evening, ladies. Do I have the campus woman in the house today? Yeah! Awesome. Well, my name is Frida Avila. I am in the West region as well. And today I get the charge of preaching about being fruitful in the dorms. And I think in order to understand the dorm Bible talks, we need to understand why dorm Bible talks are so important. And so I want to let you guys know that it's important because we get freshmen. We get people that are going to help build our ministry up. They're going to be with us for 4 years. We're going to be able to raise them up and help them, you know, get more Bible studies. Secondly, we're going to find athletes. We're going to find people who are going to make the kingdom look attractive and are going to help us get fit. Amen. Thirdly, we're going to find intellectual people, people that are on campus, people that are devoted to being in their academics, people that are always going to be there. And lastly, we're going to find leaders, people that don't waste time. They're always on campus. They're committed to being in school and living in school. And so my first point, having a heart like Jesus, and I wanted to turn over to Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, because in order to have an awesome, fruitful Bible talk in the dorm, you need to have a heart like Jesus. So verse 35, it says, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. And I love this scripture because this is Jesus' heart. Jesus went out and he saw, he had compassion for the people. He had, he saw them as harassed and as helpless. And I think this is what it takes to have a heart like Jesus. And even for me, you know, for being on campus, I remember Ricky and Colleen were like, yeah, we're going to go to UCLA. And I was like, oh my gosh, like, this is crazy. You know, and I totally got taken away by the facade of people. You see people in the dorms, you know, that girl's like super fit. Or, you know, that girl is like a straight A student. Or, oh my gosh. And I think you can get, like, as disciples, we can get carried away with this facade of, oh, they're okay. That girl seems like she's happy. You know, she has a boyfriend. Her life's put together. She's doing great. She's spiritual. But we can't do that, guys. We can't be taken away by the facade of the people. We have to really see where they're at. And like Jesus did here, it says he saw them as harassed and helpless. But I think in order to even see them like that, we're going to see what Jesus did. It says that he went through all the towns and villages. So Jesus wasn't... He just didn't go on campus and was like, hey, these people are harassed and helpless. He was working hard. Jesus was sharing his faith. He was going from town to town healing people. And I think in order for us to have compassion for the lost souls in our campus ministries, especially in our dorms, we first need to be able to be hard workers for God.
Yeah.
Secondly, you have to have creativity. I think a lot of the times we can be like, oh my gosh, I have to share like for 8 hours on campus. But no, you don't. You just have to be on campus for like 8 hours, you know? And you have to make it creative. Do fun things. Go on Pinterest. DIY things. Make things fun. Spice up your Bible talk. Search up recipes. Search up those, like, there's like this little video on Instagram. It's like 5-minute recipes, and they're like super cool. I like can't even, it blows my mind every time. But yeah, just make things interesting. Plan events. For UCLA, we had taco nights. We had frisbee nights. We had movie nights, study nights, family times, prayer walks. Make it fun. Make being on campus fun. And also, I like, in Christmas, I was at home in Portland, and Caleb came over, and he's like, man, I'm just going to be radical. Like, I'm young. Like, I'm going to read the Bible in a month. And he was just, like, inspiring me. And even with all these lessons, like, we really need to be bold women in 2019. And I just really want to encourage you guys, stay up late. Go to sleep late. Wake up early. Like, you guys are young. Get to do the crazy things that you've always wanted to do. And just even going back to the scripture, it says in verse 38, ask the Lord of the harvest. And so in order to even be fruitful in the dorms, you need to pray. It starts in your quiet times. It starts in your prayers. And last but not least, I want to challenge all of you to take the women you disciple and the women in your Bible talk and spend at least 2 hours in the dorms. Just, you can do whatever you want. You can share, you can study, you can eat. But just make sure that you prioritize that time to be able to have fruitful Bible talks in the dorms.
Amen. My name is Haley, and I have the amazing charge of staying zealous in the face of persecution. As women of God, we can only expect to be persecuted. So there's two things that we need to remember, who we are and who we want to be like. I know for myself, I love studying out what God thinks of me. I love studying out how I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I love thinking about the fact that I'm a daughter of a king. And when expecting persecution, this is something I consistently have to go to. To be honest, though, when persecution comes, I often have a battle of my mind. It's easy for me to be a warrior on the outside. I've always been a tomboy. In high school, I was on the wrestling team. I was about to sign up for the military. The night before I was supposed to enlist in the military, I studied the Bible and they challenged me not to enlist. But I have always been that person. I passed my concealed carry to have a gun. That's who I am. That's who I am in my nature. But the battle of my mind is so different. Because when people say things to me, it destroys me on the inside. And if we're honest, here in the United States, most often we won't face those battles where we have to go to war, where I have to be on the wrestling team. I won't usually have to do those things. So as women in the campus ministry, we're often faced with the battle up here. When people tell us things, when they tell us that we're not good enough, when people tell us that our Bible talk is weird or stupid and we need to stop sharing our faith,
when people tell us things that really harm us. So we have to remember who we are as women of God. We are warriors. We stand strong and we fight for the truth no matter what. The Bible that we hold in our hands today is blood stains with the hands of women who fought for us to have it in our hands today. So how dare I cower back because of something that someone told me? So it really requires me to study my Bible, to get in deep into the Word, and to remember who I am. We can't afford to lose this battle. There are women every single day on campus who are fighting, who are longing for you to open your mouth. But if you're too afraid that this person is going to say something that's going to hurt you, like the last one, you could lose a soul for eternity. I know for myself, when I was living in Denver, this is something that I really struggled with. Amongst my friends, I was the popular one, and I always did the outgoing, fun stuff. And whenever my friends would tell me that I was weird or that I didn't fit in, I always wanted to cower back and not say the truth. I know for myself, even within disciples, it can be hard to speak the truth. I know that there have been sisters that thought it was uncomfortable or stupid for me to have my quiet times early in the morning on campus or to do different things. And so I would want to cower back. But I have to remember who I am in the scriptures. The second thing is know who you would like to be like. In John 15, 20, it says that the master is not greater than the servant, and the servant is not greater than the master. And if Jesus was persecuted, we ourselves will be persecuted. We have to grab persecution by the horns and face it face to face. Pray for persecution. Pray that when you preach the word in your Bible talks, that you receive it, because that is what means that you're a godly woman. Pray that you can always, always, always face persecution with love for the other person, because this is not a battle of flesh and blood. When our parents persecute us, when our family members persecute us, when our friends persecute us, it is not about any of that. I want to leave you with the scripture in Philippians 4:4, which says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I tell you, rejoice." If we are in our Bibles, if we're praying and we remember who God is, we rejoice. So I want to leave you with these few practicals as I close to remember who you are in the face of persecution. Know what you're preaching so that when you're faced with it, you know how to construct it and you know how to battle it. Number two is know how you respond to persecution. Do you get angry or sad? And find scriptures to face that ahead of time. Enjoy every single day knowing that you're a daughter of Christ, and always remember that whatever is going on in your mind, you can always find scriptures to refute it. Thank you so much.
Hello, ladies. How are we feeling today? Fired up. Great. Good to hear it. Well, I'm very excited because I've been given the charge of Solomon's Colonnade. Now, when I got this, I was like, what? And as I studied it out, I understood, okay, I do know what this is, just never used the term before. So let's go ahead and flip over to a scripture that's going to help us understand this a little bit better in Acts chapter 5. As we make our way over to Acts chapter 5, I'm going to start reading in verse 12. It says, "The apostles performed many signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's Colonnade. No one else dared join them, even though they were highly regarded by the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. As a result, people brought the sick into the streets and laid them on beds and mats so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds gathered also from towns around Jerusalem, bringing together their sick and those tormented by impure spirits, and all of them were healed." This is an incredible scripture because we see this is the place that the disciples met. They knew, like, people knew that if they were going to go anywhere to meet a disciple, it was going to be in Solomon's Colonnade. And this is what we need to establish on our campuses. Okay. Do the people on your campus know where to go to find disciples? Well, I have a couple practicals just to help us to get to that point. As women, we have to pick an open and friendly space. We got to help the men who lead our Bible talk and the men of our
Bible talk together, make sure that we can collectively take our ideas up and find a place that's going to be suitable for not only Bible talks, but D times, for just open discussions, for being able to do Bible studies there. This is, should be the place that people are like, oh yeah, as they're walking by, they're like, oh yeah, this is where all the disciples meet. But do we have that? There is a woman who's on the El Camino campus. She's not open to studying the Bible, but every morning she will walk by and she's like, hey, you guys are still at the tree. Like, she knows exactly where we're going to meet because we're always there. But she always knows that she can come and we can have great discussions. And she loves meeting with us because we've made that environment really great for her, which is my second point, is establish a safe environment. As women, we're very nurturing. It's in our nature. We love to nurture and love up on people. And so as the women of our Bible talk, we have to establish that into the character of all of our women to create a space where people feel safe to come and discuss the Bible. People don't want the picket fencers who are like, you're going to hell. Like, no one wants that. We want to make sure this is a place that people can come into and feel super safe. But also, we want to make sure that our attitudes and our behaviors are right as well, because in this scripture, it says that the apostles were highly regarded. Like, everyone knew that those were the disciples and they're going to act the same way. So as disciples on our campus, we have to act the same way. Number three, don't give up. In verse 13, it says, no one else dared join them, even though they were highly regarded people. People are probably going to think you're a little weird. We're disciples. We do things that are crazy to people. But don't give up, because the apostles weren't like, you know what, this place isn't open, so we're just going to switch locations, you know, mix it up because, you know, this space isn't open, right? We can't do that on our campuses. We have to stay established and continue to meet in the same places so people know where to find us. And because of that, it says that all of them were healed. Not some, not a few. All of them were healed. Women are going to know that they can come to this safe space, and we have to create this place on our campuses for the women and even men to come to. Glory to God. Thank you so much.